This is the third module on convolution sum. We have seen in the first module, we saw what is convolution sum, which is given by the output of the system yn is equal to sigma m equal to minus infinity to infinity x of m h of n minus m h of n minus m. And we saw different methods of evaluating the convolution sum in the first module. In the second module, we discussed a few properties of convolution sum. We shall continue with some more properties on convolution sum in this module. So, continuing with the properties of convolution sum, we shall first take up the property wherein we try to convolve a one long sequence with one short sequence. Short sequence, and there are two methods of doing it. One is the overlap. One method of doing it is the overlap add method, and the other is the overlap save method. Overlap save method. We shall see both these methods of evaluating the convolution sum. And this will be followed by one more property. And later on, we'll take a few examples. Now let us take up the overlap add method of overlap and add method of evaluating the convolution sum. And let us say Xn is a sequence of large length, say x0, x1, x2, x3, say x4, x5, and so on, a large length. And let us say we have an impulse of length, say h0, h1, h2, of length m. Length m. The impulse response is of length M. Now, in this method, we are going to split the input sequence into non-overlapping. Say I split the input sequence. The input input is split into non-overlapping short length sequences. Short length sequences such that if I just concatenate all of them, I will get back my original sequence, say x1n, say x2n, and so on. So I am going to have few, I'm going to take my long sequence xn and split it into shorter sequences. And the split can be of any length. They need not be equal length. We can just split it into shorter length sequences. These sequences are non-overlapping. And then we compute say y1n, which is given by the convolution of the first sequence x1n convolved with hn. Similarly, we compute y2n, which is given by the convolution of x2n convolved with hn. So each of these short length sequence, we evaluate the convolution and say y3n and so on. Say x3n convolved with hn. And after evaluating the convolution to get the final result yn, what we do is we write the results of y1n. Let us say y1n is say a0, a1, a1, a2, and so on. And let us say y2n results in say b0, b1, b1, b2, and so on. And this sequences are short duration and depends on the actual length of x1 and hn. And say this is c0, c1, c2, and so on. So to get the result, what we write is, we write this a0, a1, a2, etc. And let us say I have my last few values. And then I also have my b0, b1, b1, b2, and so on. And say c0, c1, c2, so on. So the last m minus 1 values. M minus one values need to be added with the first m minus one. These are going to be my last m minus one values, and say these are my first m minus one values. These two I need to overlap and add. Similarly, from the second sequence, again the last m minus one values are to be overlapped with the first m minus 1 values of the third sequence, and so on. We can overlap the results of each of these individual convolutions, and the overlap is equal to the 1 less than the length of the other sequence, that is length of hn. Usually hn, the impulse response will be of a shorter length as compared to my input, which is going to be of a long length. And once I do this, I get my get the result of my convolved sequence. So let's take an example for this method of evaluating the convolution sum. Let's take an example. Say xn. Let us take say xn. Xn is say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Let me take xn as in this manner. And let me split my sequence now. Say x1n. Let me split my sequence as x1n as say 1, 2, 3, 4. And say 5, 6, 5, 4 as my second sequence. And this is going to be my third sequence. So let me call say x1n as say 1, 2, 3, 4. And let us say x2n and is say 5, 6, 5, 4. And say x3n and is say 3, 2, 1. And let us say our input, let us say my impulse response hn of the system is say 2, 4, 6. 2, 4, 6. So now I need to evaluate the individual convolutions, say y1n. And what is y1n? This is going to be x1n convolved with hn. And similarly, my y2n is going to be x2n convolved with hn. And my y3n is x3n convolved with hn. So let's take the help of MATLAB in evaluating these convolutions. Just to save time, we have seen different methods of computing convolution, and we know to compute it by different methods. So my x1n is given by 1, 2, 3, 4. My x2 is given by 5, 6, 5, 4. And my x3 is given by 3, 2, 1. These short length sequences need not be of equal length. They can be of any reasonable length that we find convenient to perform convolution. And hn is given by 4, 2, 4, 6. 2, 4, 6. And what is my xn? My original full sequence xn is actually all of them together. So x1, x2, x3. So this is my xn, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And what is my result? Yn, yn is convolution of xn with hn. And if I simply perform convolution, my answer that I'm going to get is 2, 8, 20, 32, 44, 56, 64, 64, 52. Let's write down. My result, my final result is supposed to be a yn, my yn. My yn, which is given by xn convolved with hn, and this is given by 2, 8, 20, 32, 44, 56, 64, 64, 52, 40, 28, 16, and 6. This is my final result. Let us now compute each of these individual convolutions. X1 convolved with HN, and let us see what are the results. So let me first convolve X1 with HN, and what I get is 2, 8, 20, 32, 34, 24. So this result is given by 2, 8, 20, 32, 34, 24. This is my first convolution. Similarly, let's compute Y2N, the convolution of the second sequence. Let me convolve X2 with H of N. And what I get is 10, 32, 64, 64, 46, 24. So let's write it down. My second result is 10, 32, then 64 64 46 and 24. Similarly, my third sequence, if I convolve x3n with hn, I get 6 16 28 16 6. So I'm getting 6 16 28 16 and 6. So let's try to perform the addition. We have done now, we had a long sequence xn, we split it into three small length sequences. For each of these sequences, we perform the convolution with hn, and we try to get the individual sequence. Now, from these individual outputs, we need to get the final result by using the overlap add method. In the example that we have taken, the length of hn is 3. So my overlap is equal to m minus 1. Length of my overlap is m minus 1, that is 2. So now if I want to write my final result yn, my final result yn is given by, so what I find is I need to overlap my last two with the first two. Similarly, the last two with the first two. And if I have some more sequences, similarly, I'll overlap the last two with the first two. And why two? Because in this example, Hn is of length 3 and the size of overlap is 1 less than the size of n. So now if I try to write my final result, I have 2, 8, 20, 32. The next sequence is going to be 34 plus 10. 34 plus 10, that is 44. Next is going to be 24 plus 32, that is 56. 56. Next I write 64 as such. I have 64. Then again another 64. Then 46. 46 plus 6, that is 52. Then I have 24 plus 16. 24 plus 16, that is 40. Then 28, 16, 6. Now let's compare if the result is right. So we have 2, 8, 20, 32, 44, 56, 64, 64, 52, 40, 28, 16, 6. So we got the right result. We got the same result. So either I can convolve as a single long sequence, or I can split into smaller sequences and get the result. This is one method of computing the convolution of one long sequence with a short sequence, and the method is known as the overlap and add method. There is another method of performing a similar convolution wherein we have a large length sequence to be convolved with a shorter sequence. There's another method, and that method is known as the overlap save method. Save method. So here, if I have a sequence xn, I have a long length sequence xn, say x0, x1, x2, and so on. And say I have a shorter length sequence hn, once again say h0, h1, h2, and so on, of length m. Now in this case, I need to split my sequence again into shorter sequences x1, x2, x3. But there is going to be an overlap. So if I have x1, x2, x3, so x1n, say x2n, x3n, then we need to have an overlap in the input itself. I'm going to have an overlap in the input itself. And the size of the overlap is once again m1 less than the length of the other sequence, the short sequence. And we now compute y1n, y2n, y3n, etc., wherein each of this is once again the convolution of this short sequence with hn. Similarly, say x2n convolved with hn, and so on. And whatever result I get, let us say a0, a1, A1, A2, and so on. This is say B0, B1, B2, so on. And say C0, C1, C2, and so on. Now to get the result, what I will do is I will discard the last M minus 1. The M minus 1 terms I discard. Similarly here, the first m minus 1 terms I discard. In the end, I discard the m minus 1 terms. And at the beginning also, I discard the m minus 1 terms. So this is how, and when I just put all the remaining terms together, I am going to get my result of the convolved sequence. So we will take the same example that we had considered, and we will now try to do the same example by using the overlap save method. So as an example, let's try to perform the convolution of this xn with hn. We take the same example just for simplicity. And so now I need to split my input into overlapping input sequences, short length sequences. So let me take my xn, say x1. Let me take say x1. x1 is say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And say x2. X2 is, so I have taken 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 as my first sequence. So my second sequence, there has to be an overlap of two elements. So my second sequence is going to be, say 4, 5, 6, and I can stop it anywhere. Let me take it as this. So my second sequence is going to be 4, 5. The last two elements are repeated, 6, 5, 4. And then I take few more elements. Once again, I can stop anywhere I like. There is no need to ensure that these sequences are all of small, same length. Now I take my x3. And how do I take my x3? I need to ensure there is an overlap. So the last 4, 5, 4 has to be repeated. There is an overlap in my input. And then I have my remaining term. So my third sequence is going to be this one. So this is my x1, this is my x2, and this is my x3. So 5, 4. 5, 4. 3, 2, 1. So now let us compute each of the subsequences, that is y1, which is given by convolution of x1, convolved with hn, and similarly say y2 is x2 convolved. Yes, so now let us compute each of the sequences. What is y1? Y1 is the convolution of x1 with hn. And let's try to get the result. And let's also get y2. And let's get y3. The convolution of each of the above sequences with hn. And let's once again take the help of MATLAB in evaluating these convolutions. Say x1. We define it as x1, 2, 3, 4, 5. X2 is 4, 5, 6. And then x3. So what I have is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 4, 5 is an overlap. And then 6, 5, 4. And then 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. This is my last sequence. So let me compute y1. Y1 is convolution of x1 with hn. So I have the result as 2, 8, 20, 32, 44, 44, 30. So I have my results 2, 8, 20, 32, 44, 44, and 30. Similarly, let me compute y2. And what is y2? Y2 is the convolution of x2 with hn, and that gives me 8, 26, 56. Then we have 64, 64, 46, 24. 46, 24. And similarly, let me compute y3. Y3 is given by the convolution of x3 and hn, and that is 10, 28, 52. 10, 28, 52. 40, 28, 16, 6. Now we need to get the final result, yn. Yn. How do I get yn? I need to get my final result, yn, which is the convolution of xn with hn. Now, this, since we are doing an overlap and save method, we have overlapped our input sequence. So, since we have overlapped the input, in the output, we just have to discard certain values. And what are the values we need to discard? The m minus 1 values. So we discard n minus 1 values. In this case, n is 3. So we discard the last two values of the first sequence. We discard the first two and the last two values of the second result. We discard the first two of the last result. And then when I put all the remaining terms together, I am going to get my result. So my convert sequence is now 2, 8, 20, 32, 44, 56, 64, 64, 52, 40, 28, 16, and 6. Now let us check whether we got the same result when we did the same problem by the other method. The method that we had used was overlap and add method, and we got the result. Let's see if the results are identical. So 2, 8, 20, 32, 44, 56, 64, 64, 52, 40, 28, 66. So we get the same result. We can use either of the methods. So now this is a property of convolution, which is useful when I have one large length sequence, one long sequence, and another is a small sequence. So if I have a small sequence, then I can use either of the method, the overlap add or the overlap save method. If both these methods give the same result, and this property comes of use when I have my sequence which is real time, or let us say my voice or audio signal or some signal that is long, of a longer duration, this property is extremely useful in evaluating the output of the system using the convolution property. So now we take up one more property of convolution sum, and that is the ninth property of convolution sum. Earlier we had seen 7, and this long convolution of the long sequence and the short sequence, if I call that, is property number 8. This becomes my ninth property, which is convolving with my input to the system is going to be my signal. Xn is equal to e to the power of j omega n. So here we have a situation wherein I have my system, my linear time invariant system, my input xn, and I have my impulse response hn, and the output is a yn. And we know that we can compute the output yn using the convolution sum. Using the convolution sum, which is given by sigma m equal to minus infinity to infinity x of m or h of m, or we also know that it is, or I can also write it as sigma m equal to minus infinity to infinity h of m x of n minus m, because we know this property of convolution. So it does not depend on the order in which I convolve the two sequences. So instead of writing xn convolved with hn, I will write hn convolved with xn. And this is what I have. So now in this example, what happens is I have my output given by yn is equal to minus infinity to infinity h of m. What is my x of n? Is e power j omega n. So e to the power of j omega n minus n. And then I have my output yn given by, this is summation with respect to m, and I have e power j omega n. So I can get it out of the summation. So I have e to the power of j omega n sigma m equal to minus infinity to infinity h of m e to the power of minus j omega m. So this is a very very interesting and a special example, because when my input xn is a complex exponential e power j omega n, Then I am computing my output using convolution, and I'm getting the output as a product of my input multiplied with the term. And if I look at this term, this is going to be a function of I'm summing with respect to m, and I'm going to get it as a function of omega, some quantity which is a function of omega. And what is this h of omega? This is given by sigma n equal m or n, I think, because it's a summation, say h of n e to the power of minus j omega n. So we are having the output as the product of two terms. The first term this term is x of n, and this is a function of the impulse response h of n. So we have the output as a product of two terms, one where I have my input as such, and the other term is a function of the impulse response h of n. So this is a completely different domain, an interesting example where the output is going to be the product of two terms. And this second quantity, which is the function of this h of omega, which is a function of the frequency of my input signal. If my input is e power j omega n, is a function of omega and the impulse response. This is known as the discrete time Fourier transform. This h of omega is known as the discrete time Fourier transform. The discrete time Fourier transform and is given by the above expression h of omega. So we have a very interesting observation. My input h of n, my impulse response h n, is a discrete time sequence. And for this discrete time sequence, I compute the frequency response or the discrete time Fourier transform, and I get h of omega. This h of omega is continuous in omega, and we have seen it is periodic, and periodic with period of 2 pi. We'll take up examples relating to this component, this property of convolution, the DTFT, in the next module. Now we shall take some more examples in Fourier in convolution sum. Let us take some more examples in convolution sum. Examples in convolution sum. As an example, let us take a sequence, say x of n, given by x of n, say, given by cos 0.1 pi n. Cos 0.1 pi n. And let us say my impulse response hn of the system is, say, 1, 2, 1. And let us try to perform the convolution of the sequence. So I want to compute yn, which is given by xn convolved with Hn. So there are two methods of computing the convolution. One is by doing a matrix method and doing the convolution. And let us take, say, the n goes from 0 to 20. N goes from 0 to 20. So then I have a reasonable representation of my signal, of my input sequence xn. Now I can also, I recognize my Hn. In this case, I recognize my Hn as, it's a very short duration. Of course, I can also do overlap and an overlap save method. I will get the same result. But let me represent my Hn as, say, delta n plus 2 delta n minus 1 plus delta n minus 2. And we know that the convolution of xn with delta n is xn. And we also know that the convolution of xn with delta n minus 1 is xn minus 1. So I have 2 xn minus 1 plus xn minus 2. So this is one way of evaluating the convolution of this sequence, where my xn is cos 0.1 pi n. So I have the result as cos 0.1 pi n plus 2 cos 0.1 pi n minus 1 plus cos 0.1 pi n minus 2. I can evaluate the convolution by this method, or I can do any of the other methods. So let's try to compute the convolution and see the results. So here I've taken a very a simple example where my input is a cosine signal, and I have my impulse response as say 1 to 1. Just for simplicity and for fast to get the results soon, let's once again take the help of MATLAB in evaluating the convolution sum. So I have my sequence. I've written a small code. So my n goes from 0 to 20. My x of n is cos 0.1 pi n, and my impulse response hn is 1 to 1, and I'm just going to perform the convolution. So yn is, I'm using the inbuilt command of convolve xn comma hn, and I'm getting my I'm just taking the length. I'm trying to plot the result here. This is all the code. Now if I want to plot the result, I'm trying to plot my input sequence xn and the output sequence yn. And I'm also plotting them as discrete time sequences, the xn and yn. So let us see the input sequence and the convolved sequence. So this is what we have. This is my output sequence. After convolution, this is my output sequence. This is my input sequence, which is the cosine function for n going from 0 to 20. And this is trying to plot both of them on the same graph. So I have my input. This blue is my input, and this is my output after filtering, plotting it as a continuous time signal instead of discrete time sequence. Now, to have a better understanding, let me just increase my length of the sequence. Instead of just taking 20 terms, let me take say 100 terms. And let me run the let me see the result, and let's run it. See, now what we have is, we have an input signal. This is my input and this is the output. What do we observe? There is a change in amplitude, and there's also a change, there's a small change in the phase. There is a phase difference between the input and output, and there is a change in the amplitude. But there is no change in the frequency of the output. So this becomes an important observation whenever I give a sinusoidal signal to an LTI system. So after observing the output, what we found is the output is also sine. It's still a cosine function, a 0.11 pi n. And there is some change in there is a phase difference, and there is a change in the magnitude. So this becomes a unique property of any LTI system. Though we have taken just one example, a unique property of LTI systems. That is, whenever I give a sinusoidal input, I can have a change in magnitude and there can be a change in the phase difference, but there will not be any change in the frequency of the signal that goes through an LTI system. This becomes an important property that comes through observing the impulse response, the convolved result. We also made a statement that I get the same result if I try to compute the convolution as the sum. So this is one method wherein we have tried to, let's see if we get the same result if I write my yn as cos 0.1 pi n plus 2 into cos 0.1 pi n minus 1 plus cos 0.1 pi n minus 2. So here, instead of using the inbuilt command, I'm using that linear property of convolution wherein any function xn convolved with the unit impulse is the same function. And if a delayed impulse is a delayed signal, so I'm trying to use the property. And let's run the same code and see if we get the same result. So we get the same result. So either way, we get the same result. So convolution can be performed by using this property or by using the any method, the convolution, the Z transform, any method that we have seen. So both give us the same result. Now let's take one more example. Here what I will do is as a second example for convolution sum. Let me take another example. And let us say in this case, my x of n is say a cos 0.2 pi n plus say 2 times cos 0.05 pi n. So I'm having two sinusoidal signals, one of a lower frequency, 0.25 pi n, another of frequency 0.05 pi, and they're of different magnitude. And let me retain my same impulse response, say 1, 2, 1. And let's try to compute the output of this system. Let's check what is the output when I have my input as sum of two sinusoids. So let's check what happens. Okay, so I have my input as say cos 0.2, I take my signal as cos 0.2 pi n plus, now I'm just changing my input, say cos 0.05 pi n. So what we have done is, instead of having a single cosine signal, I'm trying to have sum of two sinusoidal signals, and let me run and let us see what is the output. And of course, let me use the inbuilt MATLAB command to compute the convolution. So let's run and see what's the output in this case. So I have my input is a sum of two sine, one low frequency signal, on that another high frequency signal riding through. And when I pass it through the perform convolution, I'm getting an output. This is my input. The blue color becomes the input and then the output. So I'm passing it through a system which has an impulse response 1 to 1. let me just change, say, we know that changing the sign of certain coefficients changes the performance of the system. So instead of having 1 to 1, let me make it as a 1 minus 2 1, and let me pass the same signal through the filter, or let me perform convolution now. Now let us see, we have a very interesting result. So now when I change just the sign of one coefficient in my impulse response, now we can recognize that we are getting the high frequency component coming through the system, and the low frequency component has got filtered out. So simple convolution operation, that too with such a small length sequence, can also be used to selectively pass desired signals. So what we found is here, both the signals are getting passed through. But when I change my input in impulse response, say 1 minus 2 1, then my output had only the high frequency component present. So we recognize that convolution is an operation which can be used to have desired frequency component and remove undesired components. Let's take one more example. Here what I have is I have a noisy sine wave, and I'm having my frequency as say cos 2 pi 1000 t. So my signal is of frequency 1000 hertz, and I'm having my same signal, impulse response 1 to 1, and I'm having performing some sampling. I'm considering the time interval being 0 to 2, and I'm also adding some noise. I'm generating some noise and adding it to the signal. So I have a cosine signal, I'm adding some noise, and my signal is of frequency 1000 hertz. This signal of 1000 hertz, I'm just going to pass it through this filter, and let us hear it. Instead of plotting, now I'm going to hear my signal. So this is my input signal XN, a noisy sine wave. So let's hear this. So this is my noisy sine wave. This is my noisy sine wave which I'm hearing. Now let me try to hear the output YN, that is, which is convolved sequence. YN is convolution. So I'm going, let me try to hear the output. There is slight improvement so some amount of noise has got filtered out, and though there is not a remarkable improvement in the filtered output, this is because we have just used the system as small as 1 to 1. Later on, subsequently, when we understand the frequency representation of a system, and when we try to design filters that meets the specifications, when we execute the same program, we will find that the output does have the noise removed. So we will see later on, when we design filters, we can remove noise. So let's take one more interesting example. Here, let me take an example. Say x of n. X of n is say 0.05, or say 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.2. 0.1 and say 0.05. I'm taking a sequence XN, and what I'm going to attempt is convolution of XN with itself. I'm going to perform convolution of XN with itself. And let us say I get YN. I get yn. Later on, I am going to convolve. Once again, I convolve yn with xn. And I get the result. I get yn. And I'm going to repeat this a large number of times. I repeatedly going to convolve my result that I get with xn. I repeatedly convolve, and let us see what result we are going to get. So I'm taking my xn, xn as say 0.05, say 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.2, 0.1, 0.05. I've just taken some numbers, and I want to ensure that this sum is 1. I've taken the sequence xn such that the sum of these terms is 1. So now let me perform say yn is the convolution of xn with xn. And let me plot the result. Plot the result yn. This is what I have. I performed the convolution of yn with xn. Let me repeat. So I want to convolve yn with xn and see the result. So this is the curve. Let me do it say few more times. I'm repeatedly convolving the output with itself, with xn, and let's see. See, we have a beautiful the curve resembles a Gaussian curve. And let us see whether I get the same result if I change my input sequence. Let me take some other sequence and see whether we get the same result. Let me now take my xn as say 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.2, 0.2. Yes. Let me check if my sum of xn is 1. My sum is 1. And let me once again try to perform yn. Yn is convolution of, as a first step, yn is convolution of xn with xn, and let's plot the result. And now we have not taken a symmetric sequence, so the result is also not so symmetric. We have the first step of convolution. Now let me repeat convolving the result yn with xn, and let's see the result now. It's somewhat smoother, and let's repeat the same command two times. And let's see the observation. It's a beautiful Gaussian response. So this is what we observe. When I take a sequence xn, which is whose sum is equal to 1, then my repeated convolution of the sequence with itself, with the original sequence xn, is going to result in the Gaussian, in a beautiful Gaussian distribution. Provided my input sequence is such that the sum is 1 and all values are positive. Let us see why we have that condition. Let us take, I have this xn. I say I have the same value, say, but I'll just make one term as negative. And let me still have my sum as 1. So I have 0.2 and 0.2. Let me check if the sum is still positive. Sum is still one. What I did is I just have one of the term as negative, but I have the same sequence. So now let us check how is the convolution. As a first step, I always convolve xn with xn, and this is the result I get. Now, as the second step, what should I do? I repeatedly convolve my result yn with xn, and this is the result I get. and say I repeatedly convolve, say I convolve, I repeat it a large number of times. And let's see the result. This does not tend to a Gaussian distribution. So repeated convolution. So what we have is repeated convolution of Xn with Xn results in Gaussian distribution. In a Gaussian distribution, provided my xn is positive, all values of xn are positive, and sigma xn is 1, which is nothing but stating that xn represents some probability distribution. Probability distribution. So any distribution, if I have probability distribution, if I repeatedly convolve that probability distribution with itself a large number of times, eventually it tends to the Gaussian distribution. Even though I do not start with Gaussian distribution, it can be any other distribution. This is another interesting property of or example of convolution sum. So thank you. In the next module, we are going to see the discrete time Fourier transform. In the next module, we shall see the response of the system when I have my input as if the input is e to the power of j omega n, and my system impulse response is hn, the output is say yn. We are going to see this special example, which will take us to the frequency response or the discrete time Fourier transform, H of omega. This is an example of convolution sum we will take up in the next module, which will just take us from the time domain to the frequency domain, the discrete time Fourier transform. Thank you.